about everybody? It's a good night to be out. The scripture reading is Jeremiah 3 and 15. Would you stand with me, please? Then I will give you shepherds after mine own heart, who will lead you with knowledge and understanding. Let us pray. Lord, we are grateful to be gathered today. Father, to be here to worship you and your holy name. We offer our worship and adoration to you, for you are worthy to be praised. Oh, Father, please, we're asking right now, have your Holy Spirit join us. God, in this special occasion, God, as we lift up our voices together to praise and offer all that we are due. Thank you for bringing us together tonight to worship and praise you, dear Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. I'm saying thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
It's an adjective. So an adjective describes so well come. The word well, W-E-L, well, C-O-M, come. Well, what did you come to do?
All right, all right.
I came to lift up the name of Jesus. I pray that you came to lift up the name of Jesus with us as we celebrate our new elect. You are truly welcome.
very auspicious occasion. Because we are faced, because of the pandemic, with so many Instagram pastors and Facebook preachers and YouTube apostles, and everybody is claiming titles without having first proven. Because he said, do the work. He says, make full proof of your call by doing the work. Okay, that's for Bible readers. And we are grateful tonight because God has, he's honored his word. And this is how he honored his words. I will send. I will heal. I will. I'm going to do it, pastors. After thine own heart, that shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. One chorus that says, hallelujah, salvation and glory.
Yeah. women and children of God.
Pastor Mars, what you saying?
Step into my world and let me take a flight with you, with our pastor.
All right.
The journey began when Pastor Brian O'Mara Sr. submitted a resume seeking employment as our pastor. Yeah. Upon arrival of the airport grounds on Cavalcade, he proceeded to the check-in counter for an interview on December 14, 2021. His current conditions were checked as he proceeded through the TSA Security Administration. To proceed to the Second Mount Olive Baptist Church terminal. Clearance was granted. Arriving at gate 5214, that's the same. Awaiting for departure on December 15th, 2021, an announcement was made that Brian O'Morris would teach a lesson.
All right.
Only minutes after takeoff of flight 2022, instructions were given from Mark 7, 24 through 30. And Brian O'Mara Sr. preached a sermon on February 27, 2022, with the subject being, "Sometimes you got to do what you got to do." While in flight, it was announced that we were encountering clear air turbulence and would have to climb a few thousand feet higher. During this flight, the Second Mount Olive membership participated in the official pastoral election on March 15, 2022, and Brian O'Mara Sr. was elected. While circling, waiting to for clearance to land, now pilot Brian O'Mara Sr. gave instructions from Psalms 119 and 5. And he preached his first sermon as pastor-elect of Second Mount Island Baptist Church on March 20th, 2022. The subject was, "Things Are Looking Up."
All right.
The flight landed at the Arthur Ray Young International Airport in the city. And Pastor Brian O'Mara Sr. and his family joined Second Mount Olive on March 27, 2022.
Yeah.
While waiting to exit the plane, Pastor Brian O'Mara Sr. was instrumental in in-person Sunday school, in-person Wednesday night Bible study, in-person baptismal orientation, virtual new member orientation, iron sharpens iron men's ministry, women of works ministry, the Tree of Life youth ministry, just
right.
A few.
Yeah.
Journeying to the baggage claim. Pastor Morris has encouraged us with the following sermons referencing the New American Standard Bible. "They counted me out, but he lifted me up." "Getting ready for greater." "Learn how to let go." "You are the one." "Enough is enough." "Go after greatness." "The recipe for recovery." And my issues has become my influences. Just to name a few.
Yeah.
Upon receipt of your baggage, I would like to thank you for stepping into my world and taking this journey with our pastor. May you be blessed as you proceed to your desired destination. This platform was originated by Sister Carly Ann Samuel, and I want to thank her for allowing me to use it. God bless you.
Like you. church on? No, Nick, why not do it right now?
First Lady, so much for everything, and
it's all of it. I'm just deserving.
Okay, so we have a lot of gifts here for both of you guys. I know we don't want to take up too much time, so you can actually look at it later or if you want. Now, on the candy, you notice they were big size. Okay, and they in two. Share one for her, for you. Or should I say one for you and one for her? If we have do that, okay. So we want to present all these gifts from the youth, the Tree of Life youth.
Thank you.
Come on, how many know God is awesome? Come on, y'all been sitting down all night. We ain't afraid of the little rain. How many know we serve an awesome God? Come on, can we just stand to our feet and for a moment give God a worthy praise? Come on, have we done anything for you today? Can we just celebrate the fact that we serve an awesome God? Come on, don't be quiet yet. We just started. We serve an awesome God. And our God is worthy to be praised. Can we give those children a hand clap? And I'm excited about this marriage between pastor and people. I'm excited about what the Lord is doing here at the Second Mount Olive Missionary Baptist Church. I'm excited about God. Excited about the fact that he makes no mistakes, that he knows exactly what he's doing. I'm excited about the fact that the people that were supposed to be here tonight are here. Amen. Also excited about the fact that the Lord knows when to send rain. We give God the Most High praise for what he has done, for what he is doing, and for what he is going to do. Amen. Just before we bring up the speaker for the hour, my wife and I, just stand for a second, honey. We just want to say thank you to Second Mile Olive for doing a wonderful job of welcoming us. Give yourselves a hand. We are honored to be able to serve and grateful for what the Lord is doing in this place. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Some of y'all get nervous when that thunder rolls. It is an honor tonight to have not only someone that I greatly respect in ministry, but someone that I call a friend. Me and Dr. Andre Lewis have been friends for over 20 years. I had an opportunity to sit with him right after the Lord allowed me to take this ministry. And we sat at a table and we talked about vision. And if you know Andre, you'll appreciate this conversation. So we're talking about vision and talking about getting things done. And I talked about implementation of vision. And Andre sat across the table from me. He said, well, Brian, there are three things you need to do. He says, you need to cast the vision. Then you need to preach the vision that you cast. So I'm waiting on some inspirational third point. And he says, lastly, you need to do what you said you was going to do. Whatever you cast and whatever you preach, that is also what you need to do. He said that way, when you cast vision the next time, they'll run because they've seen the vision come to fruition. That is the kind of wisdom that is found in the pastor of the New Faith Church. It is my pleasure and honor to introduce him to some and to welcome him to the other. Let's stand and receive Dr. Andre Lewis of the New Faith Church. Come on, let's make some noise for him.
You may be seated in the presence of our God. Great is the Lord and greatly is our God to be praised. How many of you glad to be in the house of worship one more time? As we celebrate this great and magnanimous God who we serve, who has been great and honorable throughout our lives. How we come this day to celebrate this pastor on his pastoral appreciation and installation service in the friend and person of my friend Brian Morris. Come on, let's give it up for him one more time. Amen. And the love of his life and the first lady of this church and the person of Rita Morris. Amen. How we thank God for you. Amen, all the officers and members of this church, and indeed a privilege and honor to be with you on this day to celebrate my friend, beloved. Thank God for him and the wisdom and the ministry that he has and God has imparted in his life. And I look forward to seeing what God is going to do here at this church. Listen, I am delighted and elated to have my lovely wife here with me again. Amen, we thank God for your presence. Kimberly Lewis, amen. And then certainly all of the members and officers of the New Faith Church, I ask that you would stand so that this church might see you on this day. Amen. Amen. Amen again. Our praise team is going to render, I guess, an A and half of a B selection, if you would. Under the leadership of Charisma Evans, we thank God for them for braving the weather. I thank God for this praise team who simply comes wherever I go and ask, and I thank God for them coming off of their jobs. Amen. Making this long journey. Amen. Listen, let's put our hands together and celebrate what they have for us. Charisma Evans and the praise team.
Come on. really come to praise Him. And not just tonight, but when you just begin to think about everything God has done, you can't help but give Him praise tonight. So we're getting ready for the word of the Lord. And I know this is the pre-installation service, and we understand that what the pastor is getting ready to do and what you all are embarking upon, you can't do it in your own strength. You've got to have the strength of the Lord. Hallelujah. And so the song says, "You are my strength, strength like no other." Can we all sing that together tonight as we get ready for the word? Hallelujah. Come on, everybody, let's lift it. You are my strength. Strength like.
when you were depleted of strength and the ills of life were too heavy for you to carry. You had the privilege of calling on a name above every other name. And you give God praise today. And you give God honor. So why don't we just take 30 seconds and just give God your best praise. Give God your best worship. And celebrate the goodness and the greatness of the God in which we serve. Amen. Amen again. Why don't you run with me to 1 Timothy chapter 1. And I want to begin reading for the time that is ours. Verse 12 through 17. While we're standing, we do acknowledge and celebrate all of these pastors who are present here today. We thank God for them. Why don't you help me lift up a praise for them, all of these pastors who are here. 1 Timothy chapter 1, and I want to begin reading verse number 12. Hear ye the words of our God. Thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength, that he considered me trustworthy, pointing me to his service. Even though I was once a blasphemer, a persecutor, a violent man, I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of who I am the worst. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy so that in me, worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience as an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. Now to the King eternal, he says, now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. The time that is ours, I want to talk from this thought, I don't deserve it. I don't deserve it. As we glean these few passages of scripture, I am reminded of what takes place in the life of young Timothy. Paul now is seasoned in age and begins to talk to Timothy about his first pastorate. Young Timothy now is frustrated because in his first pastorate, he's dealing with a group of people who do not receive him as they ought to receive a pastor. They don't receive him with the love. They don't receive him with the honor that is due him as the man of God. There are some there who are causing issues and strife in the church that Timothy now has given leadership to. Timothy is frustrated and feels as though the people of God are untrustworthy. He's agitated on every side. He then gets this letter from Paul, who hears the frustrations of this young preacher in his first pastorate. Paul now is older now and seasoned in age and begins to share with Timothy what many senior pastors ought to share with younger preachers. He helps him to appreciate, Timothy, you're not all that. When you begin to consider all of the things that you have dealt with and what it took for God to make you what you are, you ought to consider the same grace that God gave you, you ought to give to those who you serve. Paul writes to Timothy with this in mind, to help Timothy to appreciate how he ought to act. But he also helps him to appreciate, let me just let you take a gleam of my life. Let me let you take a snapshot of what God did for me. Paul begins to share with him that if it had not been for God who did what God has done for me, I would not be in the position that I'm in. He says, I was an insolent man. I was a sinner. I had done some things that God should have wiped his hands off of me. But he says, the grace that God gave me, I recognize that I don't deserve it. And he said, it's because of that grace and mercy that God has done for me is why you ought to do that for those in whom you serve. And I stopped by tonight just to help you to appreciate that when we look over our lives and gleam into the window of our past, all of us ought to remember that we don't deserve it. When we consider what God does and how God moves in and throughout our lives, we ought to remember that God did it by his grace and his grace alone. As Paul now writes to Timothy, he helps him to appreciate this movement because he wants him to understand that if you're going to pastor in the season and the life of the people of God, you're going to have to pastor with grace in one hand and mercy in the other. Because he wants him to appreciate that real pastoral leadership is not just about being served, but is ultimately about learning how to serve. And when Paul writes to
to Timothy, he writes to him with this in mind so that he would recognize the grace that God has given him. It's right here in scripture, unless you think I've made it up. Because the first thing that Paul says to help Timothy to appreciate the grace that he does not deserve is in verse number 12 through verse number 13. Hear it again in your hearing. He says, I thank Christ Jesus, our Lord, in verse number 12. The first thing I want you to remember tonight is that you are graced to serve because the Holy Spirit enables you and strengthens you. He says, I thank Christ Jesus, my Lord. Helps them to appreciate that I want to give credit to who credit is due. When Paul begins to look back over his life, he recognizes that it's not his education, it is not his upbringing, it is not his citizenship. He recognizes that he is where he is because of the grace of God. So when he writes to Timothy and he gives them this auspicious message, he helps him to understand that I am where I am because of God and God alone. So he opens up verse number 12 by simply saying that I thank God, Christ Jesus, my Lord. He says my thanksgiving is in the fact that he should have left me where I was. My thanksgiving is in the fact that I don't deserve to serve where I am. He said, but when I consider who God is and what God has done for me, I thank Christ Jesus, my Lord. I like that because it is a reminder to us tonight that when we look over the annals of our lives, that we too ought to be standing in awe and in thanksgiving for the goodness of God and all that he has done. And I wonder, is there anybody other than me that don't mind testifying that my gratitude is for the grace that I don't deserve? Him to serve. He says, I thank God not only because he should have left me where I was, but he says, I thank God because he gave me the strength I need so that I can serve. He says, God had strengthened me in some key and critical areas of my life. Let me submit to you, friends, that pastors are not Superman. Let me submit to you that we hurt just like you hurt. Let me submit to you that we have pain just like you have pain. Let me submit to you that our children act up just like your children act up. Let me submit to you that we go through the struggles that you go through just like everybody else. And Paul says that in order for him to get where God wanted him to go, he needed the strength that comes from God and God alone. Paul says to young Timothy that sometimes the strength that God gives you is physical. And I want to submit to you that there are moments in the life of every preacher, pastor, leader, minister of the gospel of God that our bodies get weak from doing ministry. There are moments where it feels like we can't get up. There are moments on Sunday where we want to stay in and flip the TV just like you do. There are moments where we feel like we don't want to go any step of the way. And Paul says that God strengthened me for the journey. But not only did he strengthen him physically, but he also strengthened him mentally. And I want to submit to you, friends, that in order to serve, God has to not only strengthen us physically, but he got to strengthen our minds. Because the enemy plays tricks on us just like he plays tricks on you. God didn't call you. God didn't want you. They didn't want you. The enemy plays tricks on us just like he plays tricks on you. And I don't know about you, but there was a season in my life where it was critical and key that I needed God to strengthen me, not just in my body, but I needed God to strengthen me in my mind. Because I want to submit to you that COVID did a number on all of us. That COVID played with our minds and our emotions, and COVID did some things with our mental psyche, but I thank God that he strengthened me in my emotions, but also in my mind. We have is that when we feel weak, that God can strengthen us. There will be some folk that don't mind waving your hand, testifying that God has strengthened you in some key and critical moments in your life. But then again, Paul says that not only does he strengthen me to serve, but Paul says, who has enabled me. In other words, he filled me with his power. God has given me everything I need to sustain me, to give me what I need so that I might be able to keep moving in the direction and the vision and the mission in which God has given me. Apostle recognized where his strength to serve had ultimately come from. And so Paul says, I couldn't continue to serve without God strengthening me in any area of my life. He says, in essence, he would have to quit or would have quit a long time ago if God had not lengthened him for the journey. Friends, the Lord never gives a person a task to do without first strengthening him so that he might be able to do what God has called him to do. You and I could never serve this long unless the Lord has strengthened you. You and I would never be in this journey this long unless the Lord had not strengthened us. And Paul says to this young fledgling preacher that you are where you are because God has strengthened you. But then Paul makes another testimony, if you will. Paul testifies as to why God has enabled him. Same verse, verse number 12, he says, because he counted me faithful. I like that, because this word counted, it is a numerical term. It is an accounting term. And he says that when God looked out into his vast membership of those who were with him, that he could count on young Paul to make sure that he would be faithful to the very end. Cause me to pause and say to somebody here today, can God count on you? Can God depend upon you? Even though with bad attitudes, can God still depend on you? Can God still count on you? He says he counted me faithful for the gospel ministry. And I like that because faithful is the Greek word here that means trustworthy. He says that Paul was so trustworthy that he can count him faithful in any area of ministry. Let me submit to you that one of the sad realities of our contemporary church is that we have so many people that are untrustworthy. We have so many people that are so immature to the level of immaturity that everything that makes them mad, they quit on God. Is this thing on? To do ministry. Like that great theologian Augustine said, God does not choose a person who's worthy, but by the act of choosing him, he makes him worthy. The church say he makes him worthy. I'm reminded of my friend who had been incarcerated for 20 years. He went in when we were in high school and had been incarcerated for 20 long years. Got out of jail. We bumped into each other at Walmart. And while we were at Walmart, we were talking around the registry. And while we were talking, he was talking about the struggles that he endured trying to get a job. He says, I was a three-strike offended. He said, I had been in jail for 20 years and nobody wanted to hire me. That I had was when I was filling out the application, they would ask you, have you committed any felonies in the last 10 years? He said, I struggled, Dre, to write this down, put this down, to let them know what I had been through or not to put it down so that I can get a job. He says, I had been denied on every level about getting a job. He said, but I heard a small, still voice say, just go on, put it down. He said, I wrote it down and got a call 2 days later. The manager of the store called me and sat down and had an interview with me. And he said, listen to what he said. He said, based on your record, you should not be hired. But he says, you've been exonerated by the courts. And so who am I to place a label on you? Should have disqualified me. He said, my record should have disqualified me. And when I consider all of the things that I stumbled over in my young pastorate, my record should have disqualified me. But thanks be unto God that God found me faithful, that even in the midst of what I was dealing with, that God gave me a chance that I did not deserve. Then, friends, I want you to see in verse number 13 this transformative grace. The church say transformative grace. He says, although I was formerly a blasphemer, a persecutor, and an insolent man. Paul takes time now to read out his autobiography. Paul takes a moment to start putting pen to paper, or parchment if you would, and begins to share as an eyewitness of his own lifestyle. Paul said that before I met Christ, he says, I was a sinful man. He says, before I met Christ, I was an insolent man. You remember Acts, don't you? That he stood by silently as Stephen was stoned to death. You remember that Paul persecuted the church and anyone who called themselves a child of God. Paul begins to look back over his life before his Damascus Road experience to simply say to Timothy, I remember where I was and how much grace it took to get me where I am. And I submit to you that if we are mature enough spiritually and we recognize where we've been, there'd be less of us pointing fingers at people in church. Here it is. Paul says that I recognize this transformative grace that God has now given me. And so Paul highlights his shortcomings as a means of identifying how much grace he really needed. Timothy was ready to write off God's people. Timothy was ready to turn in his resignation. Timothy was ready to say, I'm through with church folk. Timothy was ready to say, church hurt got a hold of me, and I don't want to deal with folk anymore. And Paul says to young Timothy, wait a minute, remember where you were. Remember what I've done. And if God can turn me around, certainly God can turn the saints of God around. Here it is, friends. He highlights for him what's going on. And so when he begins to highlight for them, first he was telling this young pastor to never get so discouraged with God's people that God's grace can't restore them. Don't miss that. He said, never get so frustrated with the people of God that God's grace can't restore them even when they've hurt you. He said, don't ever get to the place that you forget the grace that was needed of you so that God can restore you. He says, because that same grace is going to be needed for you to pastor a people who are sinful to the very core. He says, you gotta remember your own sin in light of what you're doing for the people of God. Then secondly, he says, never forget your own testimony of grace. He says, you gotta remember what God did. But then friends, let me submit to you in verse number 13, something else that you ought to see. Because in verse number 13, he says, because everything that I did, he says, I did it ignorantly. Let church say, I was ignorant. Secondly, he shows us the grace to serve is so abundant that it extends to the undeserving. Because when we look at 13b through 15, Paul now not only highlights his autobiography, but Paul now highlights this attitude that I was undeserving of what God had graciously given to me. Paul explains that I didn't intend to be sinful. He says it wasn't out of presumption or out of defiant sin. He said I just didn't know what I was doing. And Paul begins to talk about this because Paul was saying to them in verse 13 that I was ignorant out of my unbelief and unknowing where I should be in relationship to God. He says, I wasn't like some folk who knew to do better and refused to do better. Paul said, I just didn't know any better. And he said, but now that I know, what I know that I know that I know, he says, now I recognize the movement of God and what God was doing in and throughout my life. Then Paul says, in that same verse, he says, out of my ignorance and my unbelief, he says, God gave me mercy. Right there in verse number 13, he says, I obtained mercy. This phrase in the original Greek is a passive voice. It carries the idea that I didn't seek mercy out, mercy sought me out. Let me see if I can say that one more time. Paul said that I didn't go looking for mercy. He said, mercy went looking for me. It carries the picture of a fisherman who takes a lure and puts it on his hook and casts it out into the deep and drags in that which he catches. He says, that's what mercy did for me. He says, when I didn't know any better, God casted his spiritual hook and reeled me in and went looking for about this leniency, friends. Not only does he talk about this movement of God, but then he talks about what mercy did for him. Yeah. He says, watch this, it's in the same text. He says, by mercy and grace Christ saved, watch this, he gives himself a label. He says, I am a chief sinner. Yeah. What would it take to save a chief sinner? What would it take to save someone who was over and above sin? What would it take to save someone who classifies themselves as the number one sinner above everybody else? Because when we look at the text, he says, note the grace that God gave me. He says, God gave me excessive and abundant grace. Stay with me. A verb that itself is sound. It means to abound. It means to increase. It carries the idea that Paul didn't just get regular grace. Paul got excessive grace. Okay, let me try to help y'all see this. He coins the word here by adding a Greek prefix that is hyper to this word grace. He says he adds this word above or over or more to a word that already means superabundant. So when you read the text, Paul says that God gave me super, 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 super abundant grace. He says God didn't just give me regular grace. He says that God adds a verb there because it took action for God to do what God did for me. And I wonder tonight, is there anybody here that don't mind testifying that you remember, just like Paul, that you were a chief sinner? You remember, just like Paul, where you had been, and you knew what it took for God to save you. And you knew what it took for God to reach down in the miry clay of your life. You knew what it took for God to extract you out of where you were. And so your testimony tonight is, I thank God for the grace that God gives me. My testimony tonight is that God looked beyond my faults and kept seeing every one of my needs. And I wonder, is there anybody here tonight that don't mind testifying that God showed up tonight to give God praise, to give God worship,
God gave me the grace to serve. And if you're here today, in this season, in the life of this church, this beginning stage of newness, this beginning stage of what God wants to do through the ministry of this pastor and this first lady. If you're here today and maybe somewhere between them coming in and tonight, you've been frustrated. Maybe you've been agitated because things have changed. Some things have shifted. Things you got accustomed to are no longer here. I want to challenge you, friend, that if you believe God, if you trust God, then you got to believe that God sent the right person for the right season to do the right thing in the ministry of this church. So if you're here today, maybe I'm talking to you. Maybe you came today. Maybe you had passive aggression. Maybe you showed up tonight. Maybe you were a little agitated. Maybe the enemy has been playing tricks with your mind. But through the word of God and the ministry of this man of God, you come to realize that God doesn't make any mistakes. And God is true to his word. If you're here today, I'm speaking to you. My prayer is that you would admit and confess and begin to start turning around. Because God needs your ministry. God needs your gift. And if this church is going to be what God intends it to be, he needs all hands on deck. So if you're here today and you're not saved and you don't have a relationship with God, I challenge you, friend, that this is your hour and this is your moment. If you're here today and maybe you're saved, and maybe the issue is you have not been under a pastor's leadership for a long period of time, you need to know today that this is the place, that this is the hour, and God wants to do something great in your life. You just have to submit to his will and submit to his way. So as they sing, this is your opportunity. Will you come? This is your opportunity. This is your privilege.
Somebody else and say, I know it was grace.
Amen. And amen.
again. Amen. Listen, we're going to do remarks on Sunday. Remarks on Sunday. But before we leave tonight, would you help me appreciate the gift of Reverend Dr. Andre Lewis at the New Faith Church? Come on, we can do better than that. Let's clap like we want to come back. Amen. We do have a quick presentation.
Amen. Thank you so much. This is just a little token of love to First Lady Kim. And this is a token of love for both Pastor and First Lady. So we'll give it to her since she's already down here. Thank
you. You know you're not getting that back, right? Amen, amen, amen. Can you do me a favor just before we dismiss? If you are a senior pastor, you're here with us tonight, can we recognize you? Just lift your hand. Just lift your hand. Let me see you. Thank you so much for coming. Amen. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. If you don't mind, senior pastors, before you leave, can I just get one picture right here in the middle? I want to be able to frame this moment and what it meant for us to have you with us tonight. Amen. My father in the ministry is here tonight, Dr. Walter Hanks Jr. Amen. 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 He never forgets to tell me that he raised me from a pup. Amen. My pastor, Pastor Byron L. Murray, is here tonight. Would you stand real quick, Pastor? Pastor will be preaching for us on Sunday during the installation service. So we are excited about having him and the Fellowship of Perfect Church. Now look, Lady Ree is telling me when I said that was my father in the ministry right there, that's her daddy. That's her daddy. Thank you so much, Second Mount Olive. We're ready. Why don't you stand? Look at tonight. We came to church on a stormy Wednesday at 7. We have sang. We have given. We have had Reverend Lewis preach us happy. And it's still only 8:30. Amen. 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 That's what I call efficient ministry right there. We utilized every moment. Ronald, good to see you, man. Ronald, me and Ronald went to Westbury High School together. Amen. Amen. I cannot believe the Lord saved two people out of Westbury High School. I bless the name of the Lord for you. Amen. Thank you, everybody that came. You don't know what your presence meant to me and Lady Reed and to the Second Mount Olive Missionary Baptist Church. Just before we dismiss, can you put your hands together one time for the committee, for the pastoral installation? What a wonderful job, Deacon and Sister Collins, Sister Margot Cook and their team. You guys rock, and we are forever grateful for it. Amen. I keep saying I'm ready to dismiss. One more time, one more thing. My parents, let them see y'all. Just lift your hands real quick. My parents are here. Yeah. My children are here with me tonight. Let them see y'all in the front up there. My youngest is back there operating alive. It is my daughter's 20th birthday. And she came to hang out with her daddy tonight. Amen. 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 Thank you so much, baby, for sharing this night with me. We're ready. We're ready. We're ready. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for what our eyes have seen and our ears have heard. Father, we thank you for the word of God that ministered to our hearts and souls tonight. Father, now we pray that as we leave this place and never your presence, that you guide us to our destinations and let us find all well. Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and present us faultless before himself with exceeding joy. To the only wise and true God be honor, power, dominion, and glory. Now, henceforth, and forevermore. And the church said, amen. God bless you. You are dismissed.